in her response. You see, we have come out of the animal kingdom. We have no difficulty with evolution and Darwin. We agree we are the extension of the animal kingdom. Now, whether the inheritance we have from the animal kingdom has been passed on to us purely genetically, means through material things that are kind of in our structure, or whether it has got some metaphysical element to it, we won't fight about it even. But we'll say we are an extension of the animal kingdom. We have come out of the animal kingdom. Now, what has happened is this. In the animal kingdom, we had to literally, for survival, we had to fight off very raw forces. Like survival, you need food, you need this, you need to kind of procreate, continue to generate your baby ones. So you're kind of chasing after women or men or whatever in the animal kingdom as well. All these tendencies were acquired in our animal stage, and we continue to exhibit them in the human condition. This is the inheritance from our animal kingdom. And we are not, we are saying, yes, we know, that is how it is. You see, the reason, look, I'll give you a simple example, and I've used that before, but it's a nice one. You know why we are tempted to buy so much food when you go to Asda supermarket? Because, you know, our animal life, I'm sorry to go back right there, in our animal life, we were starved. We were struggling to get enough food to survive. And suddenly we find, with a little plastic card, and Asda in front of us, we have no problem. We can fill the trolley. I'm really, really lightening up. But you see, this idea, must consume, must eat everything, more. Even if I don't need it, I must stuff myself. It's inherited from the animal kingdom, where we needed to survive. And that survival instinct was very strong. We are not blaming it, because that allowed us to continue to be human. So we are not saying, oh, villainous stuff, horrible stuff. We are saying it's natural, it's understandable. But that comes with us into our human kingdom and makes us do things which are perhaps not necessary. And we continue to, in a way, exhibit animal tendencies in the human state. And this is what is indirectly being asked in this question. What are these vasanas, and where do they spring up from? Why do they bother us so much? They come from many previous lives. They are stored, if you like, in our subconscious. And they continue to bubble up, and we don't know. But because they are stored in our subconscious, we are not even conscious about them, and yet they influence our decision, like shopping. So, let me continue. So, the thing is, so in a way, we inherit many of these tendencies that we can continue to show in the human kingdom. Now, what is the difference? Why should we carry on? This is why not. In the animal kingdom, the determining faculty that we call buddhi, or if you like, our intellect, which allows us to give a sense of perspective, was not visible. Animal just gobbles up, he keeps eating, he doesn't have any clue, because he just, that's all survive, living at the level of the instinct, not at the level of the intellect. They operate at the level of the instinct. Nothing wrong, that's the only way they would survive. They just walk like that, you know, food, run, chase, eat. Otherwise, they would not survive. So, at the animal level, we are operating purely at the level of the instinct. It's just natural, if you like, our tendency that we acquired from our childhood or from many previous lives even. In the human kingdom, we have got an extra tool. Now, this tool was there in the animal kingdom, but it was rudimentary, very basic. Even a monkey knows, you know, now they do experiments. A monkey knows that if he goes to the club and he's got a nut, he can crack it. He knows how to get to reach the little soft part. So, even the intellect is there, but it's rudimentary, very basic. In the human kingdom, we are blessed that the intellects become more available to us, free-flowing. And we are able to access the intellect. That's why we can make sense of the world and harness the universe, the forces of nature. In the animal kingdom, we are thumped by the forces of nature, and we run away from it, saying, oh, fire, run. Here we say, now we know we can cook food with it. So we have a spouse and we press a button and the fire comes on. We harness it and cook food on it. So you see, we are able to, from the animal to the human, we are able, this intellect that appeared to be a kind of somehow innate structure becomes more revealed. In the human kingdom, we can use it for our betterment, for the harnessing nature. Rather than be buffeted by nature, pushed about by nature, we are able to harness nature for our benefit. So that is how the intellect becomes more kind of important in the human. This is what Richard Dawkins teaches. He said the reason why we mustn't, you know, kill the weak and survive all the fittest, that is in the animal kingdom, is because we've got the intellect and it says, no, not necessary to do that. You must help the weak, not kill them. See, the Dawkins, see, recognizing the, if you like, the metaphysical dimension coming into play, your intellect now dictating to you how you should behave, not your instinct, not the animal instinct, but the human intellect now beginning to rule over, hopefully rule over. Majority of human beings operate at the animal level, I'm warning you. They operate at the animal level. And it is understood, we shouldn't vilify them. We should come out of this. So we continue to exhibit those tendencies. I do that. I love chocolates. I love it. You have to stop me. So you see, this is my animal's level, kind of showing it, showing its colors. But this is, if you like, the basis of vasana. Desires that were perhaps frustrated or not fulfilled in many previous lives, they continue to, in a way, lurk in our subconscious and continue to exhibit their colors in our life, in the human life. So what our religion says is that harness them. Remember this thing. This religion that we come from is a very mature religion. It's not a simplistic religion meant for simpletons. It's a very mature religion. Look at the prescription it gives. He says desires are just as you in the animal kingdom, your desires to eat and consume and procreate. Desires will continue to continue to come into your system. If you bottle them up or hide them or kind of ignore them, you do it at your peril. Because the moment you turn into a psychotic case, means inside you are buzzing, but you are holding it down, you are bottling it up. You know, you become a dangerous person. You can't, untrustworthy person. So the Hindu didn't recognize. He said, we know the trick. Fulfill them in a legitimate manner. Desires are fine as long as you fulfill them in a legitimate manner. What do they mean? Start harnessing them. Don't let go completely. Don't go wild. Fulfilling any desires in every day. So, okay, you say, I must eat. Okay, then you must eat three times a day. Oh, eat three times a day. Have nice cereals. Have this. So, in a way, it is allowing you to fulfill desires, but in a controlled manner, thereby showing that you are moving from the animal to the human level. And by harnessing this kind of animal instinct, we are hopefully going not from the just from the animal to the human, from the human to the divine. This is the idea of the Westerners' worries. What is all this divine stuff? Where did this appear from? Just be good human beings. We say, good human beings means divine. Basically, when you show the human traits become much more visible in your lives, you're already now reflecting that you've moved away from the animal kingdom a long way. In the animal kingdom, kill the weak, survival of the fittest is the rule, name of the game. In the human kingdom, we come with new ideas. Help the weak, lift them up, don't crush them. This is what we would call not just being humane, but we would say divine, relating to our divine nature, something that is much more to us than just meets the eye as a little physical being. And that is being reflected in the way we lead our lives. So desires, don't bottle them. At the same time, don't let go loose completely saying anything goes now. In a controlled manner. You see, that's why, look at the lovely way we have done this. They say the four aims of Hindu life are dharma, artha, kama, moksha. They say, all the time be aware of a deeper dimension. That's what dharma means. Artha means, yes, make sure that you are able to make a living, create wealth, make money. Kama, fulfill legitimate desires. Continue to fulfill. But then the final, kind of, if you like, target is, the idea is that while you are fulfilling desires in a legitimate manner, in a controlled manner, harness them. Rise above them. That's called moksha. So what was, and do you know how you rise above? Not by hiding them, but while you are fulfilling your desires, you are aware, this is desire, I'm fulfilling it. Oh, okay, how much when I chew this cake, how much pleasure did I get? Oh, this much, tomorrow this much, oh dear, it's not working, is it? This is called, if you like, fulfilling desires in an intelligent manner, in an observant manner, in a mindful manner. And when we do that, then these desires immediately become harnessed. So you see this idea of moksha, basically rising. You see, this is the whole aim of Hindu life. You may think Hinduism means finding God. No, no, that's a ploy. Hinduism means, this is the heart of Hinduism. It is not searching for a God. It is searching for freedom from every limitation. You see, we all have limitation, and there's something stirring up within us which doesn't like to be contained. It hates any limitation. So you see, first of all, we say we don't want nature to buffet us, so we say put nature outside the thing, inside is warm. We can control nature. So we look at, if you like, overcoming our physical limitation. Then what do we do? Suppose when you say somebody loves poetry and somebody loves music and art and literature and philosophy, what is he trying to do? He's now trying to transcend.